but he decided to call you. It makes me feel like I need to do my greatest and just put all my energy as the people that were part of the party that I was in when I was 10. I want to be the same thing now. I want to give all my energy, because you never know who around all of those children are becoming pastors, are becoming servants. We're not just giving gifts to the children. We are opening doors for them to understand that God has an entire life for them. God has a plan with every single children that is receiving this shoebox. Today, I have the privilege to be the senior pastor in the Hechos 29 Church in Ambato, Ecuador. This simple shoebox gave me the chance to see my great father loves for me. And now that's the reason that all Sunday mornings, I'm so excited to go to the church and share the gospel and preach. It gave me the chance to see that there are many people just like me that are in need, maybe just of a hug or just to hear that Jesus loved them. And now I'm able to do that because someone just heard God's voice and put a black jacket on my shoebox. Man, it's just so crazy that people are just so willing to give something from themselves. But that is God. It's God working through people for other people. And for the ones that are packing shoeboxes, man, thank you very much. You are doing a huge, huge work just hearing God's voice.
All right, we are excited. The Christmas season is coming and shoebox time, so I hope that you all take advantage of that out in the lobby. Would you please stand as you're able and join us as we begin our service with a call to worship from Romans chapter 8. This is the word of the Lord. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit who gives life has set you free from the law of sin and death. For what the law was powerless to do, because it was weakened by the flesh, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh to be a sin offering. And so he condemned sin in the flesh, in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fully met in us who do not live according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Amen. Amen.
Thank you. Good morning. It's good to have you guys being able to gather back with us in person this morning as we open up our prayer time. This Sunday happens to be the Sunday we remember the persecuted church, and so we want to take a few moments and pray for our brothers and sisters in Christ that are throughout the world that do not have the benefits and the freedoms that we have. And then also, I'm sure we're all mindful of our freedoms that we have as Americans and being able to vote. It's been a little wild election this year, and some pastors have decided to come out and share how they voted. And it's pretty controversial, but I have decided that this election being it is that I really feel like I need to share with you how I voted this year. So I want to explain what I did. Of course, first of all, I prayed before making my decision. Then I went to the polling place, and they gave me a ballot, and I took it into this little booth area, and I got a pen. And the person you want to vote for, I filled in the circle, and I filled in the whole circle, the whole thing. And I did it for all these different people, because there's lots of people apparently running for stuff. And then I took the ballot, and I took it over to the guy, and he put it in the box. So I know that's controversial to share how you voted, but as a pastor, I wanted to share with you how I voted this year. I hope that you will do the same. So will you guys join me in a word of prayer? Heavenly Father, we are so blessed to live in the country that we live in, the opportunity to have a part in saying who our leaders are. And we thank you, God, for that privilege. We are mindful of the individuals throughout history who have secured those rights and those privileges for us, and we want to take advantage of that. But Lord, we're also mindful that come Wednesday, for some of us, the candidate we voted for will win, and for some of us, the candidate will lose, but you will remain on the throne, that you are King Jesus now and forever. And Lord, we are mindful of our brothers and sisters in Christ throughout the world that do not share in the freedoms that we have, that are being persecuted mentally and emotionally and physically, but Lord, who are remaining faithful. And so God, we pray that they remain to stay faithful in the world in which they're being persecuted, and we pray that we also will remain faithful. Lord, we welcome you in this place, and we're excited to worship you, whether it be here in person or if it is at home. For Lord, we know that your Spirit unites us together as one. In your precious and holy name we pray. Amen. Jason's going to continue to lead us in a time of worship and celebration.
Amen. Would you please stand once again as we continue? Hopefully you notice a theme in our songs today. As Chris is going to be preaching about the doctrine of the Trinity, the songs remind us that God is one in three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Oh, praise Him.
to focus on our God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. He is the creator, the maker of heaven and earth, and he reigns over all, and yet he has revealed himself to us through Jesus Christ, a humble man who took on our burdens and our sins. Take whatever this world can throw at you. And you did. You took it on the cross. You took our sin, our suffering, every failure, every way that we fall short. God, you took it upon yourself. Praise you. Praise the name of the Lord. He is the name of have hope, we have certainty, we have confidence because of his great love. We pray now as we turn to your word, help us to believe. Help us to receive what you are speaking to us today. We pray in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. You may be seated.
All right. Good to see you guys as we get together. So with the elections going on, there's often been a lot of talk about American history and knowing your history and who knows their history. But what amazes me is, as Christians, we have thousands of years of history, and yet so many of us don't know our Christian history. And that impacts our faith. It seems like something we should want to know. For example, yesterday, I know most of us called it Halloween, but yesterday was Reformation Day. It's where you remember when Martin Luther nailed the 95 Theses to the door of the church and started what became the Protestant Reformation, why you're here today. Then today is known as All Saints Day, and it's a day when we remember Christians throughout history that have served and the things they've done, as well as Christians throughout the world. So with those two things in mind, I kind of want to step away from James this morning, and I want to do a little church history lesson. Now, I'm not going to do all the church history. As a matter of fact, I'm just going to focus on one event. It occurred in 325 AD in a city called Nicaea, and it was an event in which over 300 Christian bishops gathered from throughout the Roman Empire to the city of Nicaea, which is today in modern-day Turkey. Now, the reason why they came together was there was a false teaching that had risen in the church, and so they came together so that they might address that false teaching. Later, they would meet in 381 in the city of Constantinople and reaffirm this document, but it's best known today as the Nicene Creed. It is the most, it is the creed that is most accepted, most widely accepted among Christian churches. Most people know the Apostles' Creed, but the Nicene Creed is really the one that is accepted the most throughout the Christian community. So the story behind it and how we come about it and what it says is very important to us. Now, as Baptists, we're not real big on creeds. We don't do a good job on creeds, and we really do a really bad job of repeating them all together. We just can't ever quite get the rhythm. So a lot of our creeds today, those statements are found in our songs. And that's why those who lead us in worship do such a diligent job to make sure that what we're singing doesn't simply have a good beat to it or a good sound to it, but that it is scripturally and doctrinally correct. Now, I keep using that word creed. What is a creed, and what does that mean? It comes from a Latin word, credo, which means I believe. And the point of a creedal statement is to explain what we as Christians believe. It doesn't replace Scripture. It doesn't have the same authority as Scripture. As a matter of fact, the creed should come out of Scripture. But the idea is to take the basic beliefs that we have and put them together in a way that a believer can understand this is what we believe, or a believer might be able to explain to an unbeliever what we believe, or sometimes we use creeds to correct information so that we continue to believe in the right way. Now, creeds are found in the Scriptures. Two good examples. One comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And Paul has been talking to the church in Corinth about keeping their faith in Jesus Christ and keeping it focused. He's dealt with a lot of problems that were going on in the church. And there in the 15th chapter, he says this: "For what I receive, I pass on to you of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried and that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas and then to the 12, and after that he appeared to more than 500 of the brothers and sisters at the same time, most of whom are still living, though some have fallen asleep. And then he appeared to James, and then to all the apostles. And last of all, he appeared to me also as to one abnormally born." So what Paul does here in this creedal statement, he may have composed it, it may have been one they already had, but the beginning of that creedal statement explains what it means to be a Christian. What do we believe? We believe that Christ died for our sins. Why? Because the scriptures say that. We believe that he was buried and that he rose again on the third day. Why do we believe that? Because the scriptures say that. And we know that that resurrection was physical because we have individuals that he met with and that he saw. So this creedal statement is great that the early church could go and someone say, what do you Christians believe? And they'd say, here is what we believe. Really simple. And then you could press it out by taking them into the scriptures. Another example of a creedal statement we have that we find is in Philippians chapter 2. I'm just going to do a few of the verses on this one. Chapter 2, verse 5 says this. In your relationship with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus. So what's going on in the church of Philippi? Well, he's talking about being unified and about being servants and about reflecting Jesus Christ. And how does he do that? He goes back to this creedal statement that describes Jesus' mindset. So he says, have that same mindset as Jesus Christ. Then in verse 6, he goes, who being in the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. But verse 7, but rather he made himself nothing by taking on the very nature of a servant and being made in human likeness. Now in this creedal statement that Paul is using to explain his point gives some incredible theological understandings about Jesus and about God. There are things that we can see and we can say there's a God. We can look at nature. We can look at the Grand Canyon. We can say, oh my gosh, there's a God. But there's a lot of things we don't know about God unless they're revealed to us in the scriptures. So what is this passage immediately telling us? Well, they talk about that Jesus was in the same nature with God, that there was an equality with the Son and with the Father, but he was willing to humble himself and to become a servant. Now, the implication to us on that is, hey, as Christians, you should be like Christ and not be talking about my equality or my rights, but talking about being a servant and focusing humility. Why? Why should I be a servant? Why should I demonstrate humility? Because that is what Christ did. So he pulls this doctrinally powerful creedal statement to explain to them how they should be living. So what was the problem in 325? Well, in 325 AD, there was a priest by the name of Arius. And Arius started having a problem because he got influenced by Gnosticism. Now, if you're not sure what Gnosticism is, I recommend you watch our video we did on Wednesday night that talked about it. But real quick, a kind of a gist of Gnosticism is that it sees the spirit as good and the flesh as bad. So your goal is to be spiritual. These are good things, and the flesh is bad things, and to escape the flesh. So when he looked at the relationship of God, and he looked at the relationship of Jesus, he said, hey, God is spirit, that's good, but Jesus, he was human. He was earthly. That can't be good. So his solution to it was to take that Gnostic thinking that he had, and he says, here's the thing. Jesus was created by God. So God's the big God, and then he created Jesus. Matter of fact, on that, maybe Jesus was the very first thing that was ever created, but God created Jesus, which means that Jesus is not equal with God. Now, that goes contrary to what we know in the scriptures. It goes contrary to a doctrine that we know as the Trinity. Let me define. The word Trinity, by the way, is not in the scriptures, but the evidence of the Trinity is. So, quick definition for you of the Trinity. The doctrine that God eternally exists in three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Each person is fully God, and there is only one God. So there's one God. For all eternity, he has existed in three persons. Now, I know that's confusing because we don't have anything in our lives that is like that, which is a reminder to us we are not God. God is different than us. But for all eternity, it has been Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Sometimes we get to Christmas and we'll talk about, and this is when Jesus was born. Really, Christmas is when Jesus came incarnate. Jesus has always been. John in his gospel begins it by saying, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So that's the Trinity that's there. Right, we see the Trinity evident in a number of other passages. I just talked about John. But how about with Jesus himself? When Jesus sends the disciples out to go and to teach and to baptize, what does he say to them? He says, therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. There's an equality there. You don't say Father and Son and Holy Spirit if it's not equal. By the way, it also was a radical statement to make. So he's speaking there of the equality that exists there in their nature, in their being. So we see this from Scripture. Everything we understand about God comes from this divine revelation. But Arius had felt that he had fallen into a problem with this. He says it doesn't fit some of the passages in the Bible. Now, when we run into a contradiction in the Bible, when we run into a passage that seems to contradict what we believe, what we need to do is back up and look at the passage and its context and what it's talking about. Often what happens for cults and false teachings is they narrow in on something to make a conclusion instead of stepping back and seeing the whole Scriptures. So we always check Scripture with Scripture. Let me give you one of the passages that bothered him. We're going to quote it from the King James. So some of you old school are going to love this. John 3:16, the first verse almost everybody ever learned. So this is old school King James. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth, I got a TH on the end, that believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Now there's that word in there, begotten. How many of you use the word begotten this week? How many of you use the word begotten in your lifetime? It's just not a word that we often use. The word comes, that translation, that word begotten, comes from a Greek word called monogenes. And one of the translations for it is begotten. And one of the understandings of that passage is in the relationship of a parent giving birth to a child. So when Sheila, she did most of the work, but I did some, had our son, she beget our son. She made our son. So we made our son. And so that begotten, that's one of the meanings for it. So Arius looks at that and he goes, if he is the begotten, if he's the monogenes, then that means he was born, that he was beget, that the Father made him. But that goes contrary to other passages in the Scripture. Remember, we just did Philippians chapter 2. You guys remember that? Just in case you have short memory, here it was. Who, being in the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used for his advantage. So we got a conflict. Arius is saying, look, he was created, he was made, he was beget. But the Philippians passage tells us, no, there's an equality there. So the Council of Nicaea comes together, 300 bishops meet together to correct this teaching and how they can communicate to people the correct teaching. And what they realize is Arius was, get this, he was almost right. Almost right is still wrong. But he was almost right. He was right that the term, when Jesus uses it, is talking about the relationship of a parent and a child. But what Jesus was not doing, he wasn't talking about begetting, being made. He was talking about the uniqueness of the relationship between the parent and the child. So that begotten can also mean that there's this unique relationship that is going on there. I think about this with my sons. There is a relationship that I have with my sons that's different than with any other person. Now, I love you all, but I love my sons. And when I first born, Andrew was born, something awoke in me that I did not know existed. I was overwhelmed with a love for him. I was overwhelmed with a concern for him. If somebody hurt him, I would take him out with my bare hands. Those of your parents understand that unique relationship that you have with your child that is unlike any other relationship you will ever have with any other person, no matter how much you care about them. When Jesus uses that word, begotten, that is what he's trying to communicate to Nicodemus. He is saying, the Father and I have a relationship unlike anybody else's relationship. Our relationship is not that he beget me, but that we share the same nature and being. That was a radical term. As a matter of fact, John 3:16, which is the first verse most of us memorize, we don't fully comprehend the theological and doctrinal importance of that passage. We often focus on, well, God loves and Jesus died, which is important, but that beget makes it so that he can die for our sins and we can have eternal life. And so modern day translations today, often instead of using that word begot, the NIV will say one and only. There's nobody else has this relationship with the Father. As a matter of fact, even as we speak about being Jesus being son, and then we talk about being children, we're all adopted. Jesus is a unique relationship with the Father. The ESV uses the word only. Some translations use the word unique, which is a correct translation for the Greek word. All of these are in agreement with what the scriptures say. There's no changing of the word here. It's just helping us better understand what is being said. Well, Arius and his followers said, okay, you got that, but there's another passage we got a problem with. And this one you're not going to be able to change us on. They said, look, in Colossians 1:15, it says this. So it says, the Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. Firstborn, right there, firstborn. How are you going to change that? He's a firstborn. Again, Arius was missing the point because he was focusing on one verse instead of seeing it in its context. What is Paul talking about in Colossians? What is the message that he's trying to convey? He is trying to convey to the people lordship of Jesus Christ. Now, this is different than our day. But back when Paul was writing, the firstborn had all sorts of privileges and rights that came with them. And it's different today. We have more of an equality with our children. But back in that day, you understand like Jesus' story of the parable of the prodigal son. You know, and they got the oldest and the youngest, and the oldest gets all these rights, and the youngest takes his inheritance, runs off. We understand the story because of that. Well, when Paul uses that term firstborn, what he is talking about here is Jesus' authority. So it's not in reference to being created, it's in reference to lordship. He is the firstborn, is another way of him saying he is Lord over everything. And it fits with the context of the passage overall. It fits with the rest of the scriptures. And here's the thing, that term lordship is reserved for God. So in the Old Testament, the term Adonai, that we often translate as Lord in the Old Testament, is a title reserved for God. So to refer to Jesus as being Lord, in the process, he is saying Jesus is divine. So Arius, caught on a word, missed the full implications of what the passage was saying. I mean, really, what's kind of sad is he was so caught up in trying to prove that Jesus had been created, he missed the importance of the overall passage, which is Jesus is Lord, which is what he really needed to hear. So the group in Nicaea meets together, these 300 bishops, and they create what is now known as the Nicene Creed. On the back of your bulletins, you have the Nicene Creed. So I'm going to let you take a look at it. We're just going to break it down real quick. So it begins with these words, we believe in one God. And then it's going to talk about each of the three persons that make the one God. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, all that is seen and unseen. I like that. It's just more than what you see. There's things you haven't seen that he has created. It goes on the next part and it says, we believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten. That word eternal means no beginning and no end. So he has always been. There wasn't any time of making him. That is the way it has been for all eternity. Eternally begotten of the Father. God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, and if you haven't got it yet, people, not made of one being with the Father, and through him all things were made. And then he begins to give us that play out of what he's done. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven by the power of the Holy Spirit. He became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again according with the scriptures. See that echoing from 1 Corinthians 15. He ascended into heaven. He's seated on the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. So the Father, the Son, we believe in one God, Father, Son, and we believe in the Holy Spirit. The Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, and with the Father and Son, he is worshiped and glorified. The bishops foresaw the next battlefield is going to be the Holy Spirit. And so they went ahead and said, and by the way, if you're just wondering, yeah, the Holy Spirit also. And it puts that all in there. It says he's spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. The term Catholic there is not Roman Catholic, but is universal, which is why this morning we can meet in person and we can meet online, and we are united across the world together with other Christians. It says we acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sin. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Now you're going to note that in terminology we always saw that eternally begotten, that God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten and not made. And so the council goes on and it lays that out to explain it to you, how the Trinity works. And then, as I said, they went on also and they talked about the Holy Spirit and explaining it. Now, everything that is found in the Creed is found in Scripture. This is not correcting Scripture. Nothing in a Creed should ever be in a way of like trying to correct Scripture or say something other than it. The Creed is simply taking what the Scriptures believe and compressing them down into a statement so that the believer knows what they believe. The unbeliever can understand what a Christian believes. The power of the Creed is that we can go and talk to somebody about Christianity. And if you've gone and talked recently with somebody about Christianity, you'll begin to talk about Christianity. And 4 or 5 minutes into talking about Christianity, you're talking about politics. And you're losing the gospel message because you're getting sidetracked, or they're sidetracking you off other issues. The power of the Creed is to go in and say, whoa, 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 whoa. This is what we believe. And talk about the Creed. As you go through the Creed, you can lead somebody right into the Scriptures and present to them salvation, so that as you're leading them, someone goes, well, do you do praise songs or do you do hymns? Let's talk about the Creed. How are you handling? Let's talk about the Creed. That lays us in and should always take us back to the Scriptures. Now, I'd love to tell you that what happened in Nicaea and later at Constantinople in 381 solved the problem. And that's it, and we're good to go. But it not. Unfortunately, Arianism still comes up. It's most notable in Jehovah Witnesses believe in Arianism. So they see God as created, and or Jesus being created, and later, so God creates Jesus, and later Jesus gains this sort of divinity. But even within Christianity, every now and then we run into some challenges on the Trinity. So as we conclude, I want to show you three areas that we often fall into, and we've got to watch out that we ourselves don't fall into those. I'm going to just talk real briefly about them. The first one is modalism. Modalism claims that there is one person who appears in three different forms. So there's God, and sometimes he shows up as a father, and then sometimes he puts on the jacket and he shows up as Jesus, and then sometimes he's wearing another outfit and he's showing up as the Holy Spirit. This is sometimes called oneness theology. See that word one? There's just one God who shows up three different ways. Or sometimes it uses the term the Jesus only slogan. And often they will say one of the signs of it is you should only be baptized in Jesus' name, which I find kind of odd because Jesus said, you're supposed to baptize in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. But behind that is this oneness theology. Well, that's not correct. We know God is one, but we know that he is from eternity existed in three persons. Another one is subordination. Now, this claims that the Son and the Holy Spirit are subordinate to the Father in their nature and in their being. Note that last part, that nature and their being. So this idea recognizes that Jesus, okay, he's eternal and he's divine, but he's inferior.
And the spirit may be eternal, and it may be divine, but it's in spirit inferior. It's a subordinate to God the Father. And so it sort of comes like a minor sort of God. But that's not what Philippians 2 shows us in other passages. He is equal with God. He is equal in his nature, and he's equal in his being. So it's clear that the Father, the Son, and the Spirit are equal. Now, there's a slightly different version of this called the eternal subordination of the Son. It is not the same thing as this issue. It is a hotly debated theological question, but it is not heretical. So simply saying it's one of those things we're not necessarily agreeing, but we are agreeing that you can agree to disagree on this one and still be within Christianity. What's interesting about this lesser argument is that both sides use the Nicene Creed to argue their point. So they're both affirming the Nicene Creed and orthodoxy in it. Another one that we need to be concerned about is triism. It denies that there's only one God. Instead, there claims there are three gods. Mormonism, the Church of Latter-day Saints, believes this. They believe that there, matter of fact, they believe there's a number of gods, but they believe towards Christianity there are three gods. Now, no evangelical in this room, no Baptist in this room would say that they believe there's three gods. They would all say, I believe there's one God and three persons. But too often, we talk like we believe there's three gods. And we'll talk about God the Father and God the Son and God the Holy Spirit as if they are three separated from each other. And that's not true. And so we have to watch, and that's why a lot of times in my sermons, I like to bring us back to this reminder of the Trinity. There is one God existing in three persons, equal in nature and equal in being. So although many Christians are unaware of the Council of Nicaea or the creed that came out from it, I doubt many of you have spent time in the library reading the anti-Nicene fathers or the post-Nicene fathers. If you have trouble sleeping, I highly recommend them to help you with that. But the impact of the creed is felt in the church today. It's helped keep the orthodoxy of the Christian faith. And I encourage you in looking at that creed to take time at it. And as you're struggling to share the gospel, use that as a way of sharing it. Fortunately, as our society has become more literate, the scriptures are much more plentiful, we're not as dependent on the creeds as we are able to go straight to scripture. But I want to give you three questions as we conclude this morning. Here's my three questions. Is this the faith I've accepted? Is this the faith I've been taught? And is this the faith I am teaching others? As I go through the creed and I read it, I ask myself, do I believe this? The second thing I do is as I look at someone teaching to me, I will fall back on the Nicene Creed and say, is what they're teaching fit the Nicene Creed? If they're teaching something outside of this creed, there's a problem in what they're teaching. And that often means I either need to get clarification in what they're saying, or they may have fallen into one of those three schools that I already told you about. And then the third thing is, when I'm talking about the faith, am I teaching this to people? Do they understand when I talk about what Christianity is? So as we conclude, I want you to look at these three questions. Is this a faith I've accepted? Is the faith I'm being taught? And is this faith I am teaching others? Now, we're not going to do this out loud because I've seen responsive readings and they can get scary. But I'd like you guys to follow along with me silently as we read the creed one more time. We believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven by the power of the Holy Spirit, and he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sakes, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, and he suffered death and was buried. And on the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated in the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, and with the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one Holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sin. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Will you join me in a word of prayer? Heavenly Father, this morning, we are thankful for those 300 bishops who gathered long ago to correct a mistake. We thank you that their hearts and their desire was that the truth of the gospels not be lost. We pray, Lord, that we will continue that tradition some 1,700 years ago to hold to the orthodoxy of the faith, to teach the truth of it, to test other teachings and see whether or not they fit to that orthodoxy, and to watch ourselves that we also teach and what is in agreement with the Scriptures. I pray this morning that as we shared this creed, that there are some who've never accepted you. They're not sure who it is they're accepting or what he has done. I pray this morning as we've gone through this creed, they know the message of the gospel now. And I pray that they will respond to accept you. I pray for those who are struggling in their faith this morning. Maybe they've been sidetracked by minor issues, by issues that don't matter, caught up in controversies, that this morning they will be reminded, this is what we believe. This is of first importance. I pray, Lord, for opportunities to share with unbelievers, and that when we do so, that this is what we will share. Not our opinions, not our insights, but the truth of the Scriptures. And as the creed says that we believe, we look forward to your return when you will be fully revealed as Lord of Lords and King of Kings. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Our praise team is going to lead us in a time of invitation. We invite you to respond. You can do so, by the way. There's a perforated sheet. You can fill that out and put it in the offering plate as we leave this morning. There's emails and phone numbers. Please make use of those and call. We can talk together. Be glad to do that Zoom. Also, if you're watching on Facebook or YouTube, you can message us, and we'll be glad to respond to that.
Amen. Would you please stand as we respond together with another one of our historic statements of faith, the doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures hear me low. Praise Him above the heavenly host.
seated. I'd like to welcome Gary Pavey to come give our announcements. Gary Pavey, everybody.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I do have a couple quick announcements for you guys. Good morning to you, first of all. Operation Christmas Child, you know, it's full effect right now. We are getting our boxes together. You have until the very Sunday before Thanksgiving is when the last day you can drop them off here at church. It's very simple. You just grab a box, fill it up with some goodies and everything. We'll get it shipped out in time for the kids overseas. It's a great mission opportunity. Now, another thing, cool thing I noticed this year is that, you know, with the pandemic going on, a lot of people were kind of leery about getting into the stores. I totally get that. There's something you can do actually online. You can do the box online. You click the items you want to put in your box. They'll fill up the box for you. You just like a boy or girl and everything, and it's pretty cool. So you need to check that out and everything. It's on their website. The youth bonfire that's been scheduled for this Saturday is unfortunately has to be rescheduled. It's going to be scheduled the Saturday after next. So Saturday, November 14th at 2 o'clock p.m. at the Goodwin Farm, we're going to have our youth bonfire. Of course, we want the kids there and have a great time. We got a bonfire, hay rides, all kinds of cool, fun things to do. And if you're a parent of youth group, you are invited also. It's not just for the kids, for the parents also. For our church here at Eastern Heights, we are responsible for bringing the drinks and desserts. Our sister church, River Ridge, are going to be doing everything else. And so we got pretty easy there. So yeah, if you can help out, that'd be awesome. We appreciate that. Next Sunday after the 11 o'clock a.m. service, we had a wedding not too long ago. We wanted to congratulate again Charles and Catherine Pretty, and they are having their wedding reception here at the church after 11 o'clock service next Sunday. So if you can make that, that'd be awesome. And so if you can bear with me about two more minutes, I'm going to read something to you here. I got a picture over here so I can remember it here. Here's some things we look for in a perfect pastor and his wife. He's a burning desire to work with teenagers. Spends most of his time with the seniors. Smiles all the time with a straight face to express a serious dedication to the church. Makes 15 home visits a day, but is always in the office when needed. Always has time for church meetings and all of its committees, but is always busy evangelizing the unchurched. The perfect pastor lives a few miles away. Also, preaches exactly 10 minutes. Condemns sins, but never hurts anyone's feelings. Works from 8 a.m. until midnight, always on call. Ready to fill in for the church janitor if necessary. Makes $500 a week. Earns good clothes, or wears good clothes. Drives a good car, buys good books. Donates $100 a week to the church. He's 29 years old, but he has 40 years worth of experience. Yeah. So folks, we have here the perfect pastor and wife here at Eastern Heights. Last month was Pastor Appreciation Month. And we want to really thank Pastor Chris, Sheila, their family for being such a big part of our family. We love these guys. Can we give them a big hand of thank you for that? Also, as a church, we got together and got a Amazon gift card to them. So we'll be presenting that to them soon. So anyway, we want to thank them again for all their hard work and how much we care about them. That's all the announcements I have for you guys. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much for this beautiful fall weekend that you've given us, Lord. Lord, we thank you for the time we get together to come together as a family to worship and praise you, Lord. Lord, we thank you for our awesome pastor and his wife and their family, for the preaching, the ministry, and the love they have for this church and the love that we have for them. Lord, we thank you for the love you have for this church. We ask that you continue being with us during this pandemic and keep us safe. And Lord, we ask that we come together as a family always to spread the word of the gospel and preach the good news. Lord, keep us safe in everything we do this week. These things we ask your son, Jesus' name. Amen. Thanks, guys. You have a great week.